to approve the agenda unless there are some changes that are wished. Raise your hand who made the motion, please. Thank you. And the second? You're good? Thank you. Those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. Then we will proceed with the agenda as laid out. First, we have comments from our Commonwealth Transportation Board members. Push your button, sir. Thank you.
There you go. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We had our meeting yesterday. It was concluded yesterday. It was a two-day meeting. Two significant things that we did at the board meeting is we passed a six-year plan, and we also adopted the HB2 process. So we're going to have a presentation here momentarily on the HB2, and we changed some percentages in terms of the weighting for Category A, and in your presentation, he'll give you further explanation about HB2. Thank you, unless you have any questions.
That it?
That's it.
Thank you, sir. Okay, Mr. Otterback from Department of Transportation.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I've got just three things, just cover real quick. One is update on the I-64 widening on the peninsula. So segment one.
We're all ears.
Okay. segment one design continues to move. The contractor is planning to start the construction in September. So we don't have a date yet. We're still working around that. One item that probably is of interest to people on the board. We are working a work order with the contractor to get a managed shoulder lane from Jefferson to Fort Eustis Boulevard. So essentially have a managed shoulder peak hour travel lane capacity there. So there will be some administrative protocol as we go through and work with Federal Highway for that to occur. So anyway, that's a significant, well, it's a good scope change, I think, to the project and to keep it moving forward and help us get through that interchange. Second segment is we did receive the response to the RFQ. So we've got six potential bidders in that one, and we will shortlist and release the RFP in July is the plan right now. So segment two continues to move forward from that standpoint. Second topic was just an update to this board, and it may be something the policy board considers, but we are moving forward with what we've termed the Hampton Roads Crossing Study. So it's the old Third Crossing SEIS. So that activity has just started. So we've got a consultant on board to do that work and get it moving. We've got some citizen information meetings probably planned within the next month, and it may be worthwhile for us to give an update of the scope of that study to this policy board next month. Okay. So the last item I usually don't talk about because it deals with an incident. So if I did that, we'd be here all day talking about incidents, but we did have an incident yesterday at the Hampton Roads Bridge Tunnel. So we had a vehicle breakdown inside of the tunnel. That vehicle caught fire. So it burned the asphalt. It melted the ceiling or the tiles on the sidewalk. So good response from Virginia State Police, partners Virginia State Police. The City of Hampton Fire and Rescue, hats off, their response was right on time. We got down. The fire was put out in about 12 minutes from the time it was reported. The tunnel was closed just over 2 hours as we got the pavement in a condition that we could get traffic back on it. Then we went back and fixed the pavement last night. So just kind of an incident, and you know, we had the ventilation fans, you know, not to, you know, toot my horn, but great response from our staff, again, at VDOT, working with State Police and the City of Hampton and their fire and rescue. So that's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
Great. Thank you, sir. From the Department of Rail and Public Transportation, Ms. Mitchell. Yes, now.
Okay. Just to follow up on the comments from Mr. Malbin, the Commonwealth Transportation Board did approve the six-year plan yesterday, and a few highlights for the Hampton Roads region regarding projects from the Department of Rail and Public Transportation. We did approve $155 million in funding for the Virginia Beach Light Rail Project, which I know will be a subject of this meeting later today, but we're very proud to be funding partners for that. In Hampton Roads, our six-year plan included for this year $17.5 million in operating funding and another $14 million for funding of various capital projects. We've also funded $14 million in operating funds for WADA in Williamsburg and $200,000 in capital projects in Williamsburg as well. A few of the significant rail projects that are in the six-year plan include $20 million for the Newport News Intermodal Station, Intermodal Facility, which is being advanced as a new passenger rail and intermodal facility there. We included $117 million in funds that are actually for Richmond area network improvements that will open up capacity for an additional two trains to Norfolk in the future, and those are CSX-related improvements. And then another $8.6 million in a Branchville siding for CSX, again, serving the Port of Virginia here. Just a quick update on the DC to RVA Tier 2 EIS for high-speed rail, because I know we get a lot of questions about that. We had a number of public meetings across the state. June 1st through the 3rd, we had over 180 people attend those. We've completed mapping of the corridor and are in the process of defining various alternatives. And again, that's for, this is our federally sponsored Tier 2 EIS, which is looking at a maximum of 90 miles per hour in top speed of high-speed rail between Richmond and the DC corridor. So, and that's it. That concludes my report.
Thank you, ma'am. For my military liaisons, Captain Geis.
Hi, thanks for the opportunity to be here today. I've read through the briefings, and we're excited to be a part of the dialogue.
Thank you, sir. Colonel Lord.
Hey, good morning, Mr. Chairman. It's a pleasure to be here. We're good with everything. Thank you for being part of the allowing us to be part of the team.
Thank you, sir. Okay, our first report is going to be from the 2034 Long-Range Transportation Plan Amendment.
We have a request from Virginia Beach and also HRT to amend the 2034 long-range transportation plan and include the Virginia Beach LRT project as a construction project. And with that, we have two brief presentations for you this morning. One is Mr. Amoruso, Chief Planning and Development Officers of HRT. He will give you a brief update on this project. And then we have Ms. Dale Stith, our Principal Transportation Planner, and she will give you a brief update on the amendment process to include this project into the 2034 plan.
Thank you, and good morning, everyone. I'm here today. It's been a little while since we've talked about the Virginia Beach Transit Extension Study, and you are going to be acting on that later on today in the consent agenda, so we thought it appropriate to bring in update to remind everyone exactly what the Virginia Beach Transit Extension project is now. We just completed the draft environmental impact statement, and within that there's embedded the Virginia Beach overall project goals, which complements the strategic growth plans that the city has put in place and supports the desire for expanding the multimodal transportation systems, connecting key points along. You can see the strategic growth areas highlighted in the red, connecting that and supporting the regional tourism and industry that is prevalent in the corridor. The draft environmental impact statement alignments that we looked at were four. We started out with the original alignment, which I'll go backwards from the bottom up. On the yellow one, alternative two, Norfolk Southern right-of-way all the way out to the oceanfront, serving the oceanfront and ending in the vicinity of Arctic. We added another alignment that served the oceanfront going to the through the hilltop area, leaving the old Norfolk Southern alignment. And then there was a truncated version of that that used the Norfolk Southern alignment, ended in the vicinity of Rosemont Road area. And then late in that five-year effort, there was an addition of a desire expressed by the City of Virginia Beach to examine an alignment alternative that ended at Town Center, which is roughly a three-mile extension. In addition to the alignment alternatives, we had the no-build option, of course, that you look at, or the do-nothing option. and two technology options, light rail transit and bus rapid transit. On the town center alignment alternative, we actually analyzed four different end-of-line options centered around Independence Boulevard and going as far east as number four, which is at Constitution, and how they could best serve both the present development area of the town center and future development area west of Independence. So the draft environmental impact statement looked at that as well. Of course, the DES also addressed the necessity and enhancement of the local bus system and express bus system. And this is a depiction of the additional routes, which are in yellow, that would serve the proposed light rail stations for all the alignment options, as well as enhanced services in terms of span of the day and frequency of service. The draft environmental impact statement was accepted by the Federal Transit Administration on March 19th, and therefore we were permitted to start the 45-day formal public comment period, which was on March 20th, and it ended on May 5th. HRT held four formal public hearings to solicit comments during the month of April. The City of Virginia Beach, in addition, added an additional public hearing in the first Tuesday in May because Council wanted to hear directly from the constituents of their cities as well. We're proud and happy to partner with the City of Virginia Beach because the City Council voted to support the Town Center Alignment Alternative, the 3.2-mile extension, as the locally preferred alternative. That vote occurred on May 12th. The HRT Board, the Transportation District Commission of Hampton Roads, endorsed that selection on May 28th. As you heard from Director Mitchell, full funding construction of the projects is reliant on two key sources from the state at a level of $155 million and in partnership with the city. The state has identified that funding in the six-year improvement plan. The city has identified their funding in their adopted budget that they just passed. So today you'll hear, I believe, from Dale Stith right after me, related to a request for amending the 2034 financially fiscally constrained long-range transportation plan to include the Virginia Beach Transit Extension Study Project as a fully funded construction project. One last thing, the schedule. A lot of folks want to know what happens next. We just completed a process to select a consulting firm to help us develop the preliminary engineering and draft final environmental impact statement. Our board will be awarding that contract at the end of this month. We start roughly in July. We anticipate a 15-month duration for the 30% design plans, and then they get turned over to the City of Virginia Beach, in which they will begin a procurement process for a design build. We anticipate revenue service to begin midsummer 2019. And with that, I think I'll turn it over to Dale. Unless you have questions.
Mr. Chairman, I have a question.
Yeah, Mr. Shep.
On the project here, congratulations to Virginia Beach getting $155 million from the state on the project. Just a basic question on understanding the mechanism, the way this is laid out. So why are we backing this into the 2034 plan if it's going to be fully funded? Is that just for justification of the $155 million from the state?
You can address that.
Mr. Shepard, the answer to your question is that for every project, in order to move forward and in order to be able to receive a record of decision from the Federal Highway Administration, the project needs to be included in the region's long-range transportation plan. When we identify the funding for construction of the project, at that time, the project needs to be in the regional long-range transportation plan. If your project is not in the long-range transportation plan, the Federal Highway will not be able to issue a record of decision.
That would be the Federal Transit Administration.
The Federal Transit, I'm sorry, yes.
Okay, and so, again, just for the mechanism, for the rest of us can understand this, the secret here, that why is this in 2034 vice the 2040, which is going to be supposedly approved next month?
The 2034 is the current adopted long-range transportation plan for the region. 2040 right now is in a draft form, and this board has not even approved the list of projects yet. You have seen the draft list of projects, and the staff is planning to come back to this board in the
July,
next couple.
Right?
Yes, yes. So until you approve the 2040, the 2034 is the formal adopted long-range transportation plan.
Okay, so this project, when it's the way it's laid out, then will be considered one of the, you know, when you talk about prioritization, because funding is already set aside for this, then this is not really in a competitive position, and it has no effect on any projects that are in the 2034 plan.
No, if you look at the list of projects, candidate projects for the 2040, this project is included as fully funded project. So.
Okay, and again, congratulations for Virginia Beach and their staff for doing a great job there. Thanks.
Thank you.
Good morning. So I'm just going to give a little bit more information about the amendment request and the amendment process to the LRTP. As Camilla already stated, our formal current LRTP is for the horizon year 2034. So we received the request from HRT for the Virginia Beach Light Rail Transit Extension. For the amendment process to the LRTP, it's one of the responsibilities of the MPO is to verify the funding plan associated with the amendment request. I showed this slide to you last month. For any amendment request, it does have to be fiscally constrained, which means there needs to be a demonstration of sufficient funding for the proposed transportation project, and this is done through a comparison of revenue and costs. For the amendment request, the funding assumptions associated with it needs to be based on reasonably available funds. These are funds derived from an existing source dedicated to or historically used for transportation purposes, and the project cost needs to be expressed in year of expenditure, and this is to properly reflect anticipated inflation. So for this amendment request, specifically it's to include the construction of the Virginia Beach Light Rail Transit Extension from the Newtown Road Station to the Virginia Beach Town Center at Constitution Drive. The estimated completion date for this project is December 2019. This amendment request was posted for public review and comment from May 28th through June 11th, and we did not receive any public comments. The project cost in year of expenditure dollars is $310 million. The funding sources, as was stated previously, there's $155 million coming from state sources, which we've listed here. The state sources include VDOT bonds, the Transportation Trust Fund, funds from the National Highway Performance Program, the Surface Transportation Program, and toll credits. There's also $155 million from Virginia Beach local funds. So the total of the state and local funds is $310 million. After reviewing the project costs and year of expenditure and the funding plan associated with the amendment request, HRTPO staff confirms the reasonableness of these funding assumptions. And on the consent agenda, agenda item number 13E, our recommendation is to approve this LRTP amendment to include the Virginia Beach Light Rail Transit Extension from Newtown Road Station to the Virginia Beach Town Center at Constitution Drive as a construction project in the 2034 LRTP.
Thank you. Any questions?
Mr. Chairman? Yes, actually, my questions I think are more, and I apologize, more appropriate to be directed to the HRT representative. And I just had a couple questions regarding, I understand with the TPO staff and the analysis, it is looking at the reasonableness of the funding in order to justify it being put into the queue, so to speak, and entered as the and as an amendment. And I want to just ask a couple of questions because I've had citizens ask me questions, and I have also been reading about light rail extension. And I guess my question would be, when HRT takes these proposed projects into account, is the cost benefit, is there a cost benefit analysis done? Because my understanding is, and correct me if I'm wrong, we're talking about $100 million per mile when we're looking at the light rail extension. And I know it seemed as though that you, how it was put, it was either you know, to continue on or do nothing. And but I also think that the options with the technology alternatives, the bus rapid transit, might be a better economic way to go. And clearly, I'm not a Virginia Beach resident, and I do. These are state funds, $100+ million that'll be going towards this, and so I consider my job is to find out to make sure that the taxpayers are being best served with this type of funding. And as on behalf of James City County, I will likely be voting in support. But I have some concerns about this. And so I guess number one, my question is the cost benefit taken into account? And I have read that the justification to extend is that if we extend, then we'll have more ridership because ridership has not quite met the expectations. And I know that sometimes projects get going, well, we've gotten this far, we shouldn't stop now. And that ends up costing an awful lot of money. So sorry, I kind of went on with five. I went from two questions to 15, but thank you very much.
That's okay. And it's a common question that folks ask all the time when we look at the alignment options and technology options. What are we looking at? And an answer from an economic standpoint, I wouldn't call it a cost-benefit analysis the way somebody that has an economics background does, but we do that analysis per FTA guidelines because originally this project was anticipated to be a recipient of New Starts funding, 5309 funding. So we follow their rigorous process, which includes an assessment of the cost benefit per se and how each technology attracts ridership, which one performs better, how it complements the existing investment, how an alternative technology might do better, and what is the difference of ridership, because in transit, unlike highways, every time you have a transfer to a different technology, you have a time penalty because you have to get off one vehicle, board another. So we look at ridership, we look at land use development potential, we look at the overall cost per mile, but we also look at cost per passenger that is to be served by the project. So while it's not a formal cost-benefit analysis, all the criteria that FTA requires for the New Starts process, we followed. And we do look at a lot of the things you just talked about, the benefits and disbenefits of each of the technologies.
What is the current cost per passenger?
Well, see, that's a little bit difficult to answer because are you saying for the TIDE or for the proposal of the, I want to be clear.
What is currently operating and what is the expected cost per user?
Until we know the final capital cost estimate for the project, because we're relying on 5-7% of engineering design now, we think 310 is the right number, but we'll refine our design costs. The calculation of that estimate is dependent on the final cost. However, we do know that per passenger trip, it will be subsidized. There is no transit system in the world that doesn't have a subsidy per passenger. Right now, the fare box pays for about 16% of the cost of a trip that a passenger makes on the TIDE in Norfolk, as compared to a bus system, a local bus, which carries about 21% per passenger through the fare box. And then there's a variety of subsidies through state and federal funding for the rest of it.
And just so what does that translate to? As far as it, based on, I know that the data is out there. I don't have it at my fingertips. As far as the current cost per passenger that's been evaluated to this point, total subsidies are still taxpayer dollars. So it's no free money. So I'm curious, what is the cost per passenger based on what is existing?
Well, for the TIDE light rail today, I don't have the exact number. Yeah, I know. I believe it's around $6.50, but I don't want to give you that exact number. The cost to carry a passenger. We charge $1.75 per passenger ride, so the difference between the two.
Mr. Chair and members, and we certainly appreciate the line of questioning. It's not unusual, and it's certainly important for the public discussion regarding multimodal transportation. We've had the opportunity to analyze the Brookings
study, and at our board meeting next Thursday, we intend to release some additional information. In terms of ridership, the FTA model for the Tide projected about 2,500 boardings. We've doubled that in a short amount of time. I think what we will be able to characterize is, as we look at the other systems, to include Charlotte, I think as a starting line, and I know there was some reference to Buffalo, that's a very different situation, a system that's been running for 20 years. But when you look at the other systems and where they were at the time that where we are in terms of a new system, I think as you add additional connections, obviously the cost per rider comes down. Another thing that we're very proud of is that since HRT was created through the merger in 1999, the board just last year at my recommendation approved the two-phase increase. We want to get the revenue from the rider up to about 23%. We think that that's equivalent to best management practices of other transit agencies. So we have some additional information to report. I think when you look at where we are in the history of our agency and where we will be, provided we get an extension to Virginia Beach, we're also looking at Naval Station Norfolk considerations. We're looking at BRT on the peninsula. I think you'll be able to see that there's an array of transportation options that are cost effective. The Connect Hampton Roads program is precisely important in terms of the long range planning of multimodal transportation. And we think that's an important element too. Quite frankly, BRT works best in some cases. We don't profess that LRT needs to go everywhere. We think there needs to be more park and rides. We think there needs to be an improved bus system. So what we're saying is that one size doesn't fit all. I think when you look at the context of where we are in connection with the other systems, I think you'll be able to see that we have a good value with the Tide.
And look, I have nothing against, I certainly, my circle's not lit up. Who shut my mic off?
It's on.
Oh, it's on. I think the concept of light rail is excellent and works. It's an excellent asset in certain areas, and I'm not sitting here trying to be negative about it. What I am doing is asking questions that I am asked, and that I consider that to be part of my job. And I think it's important, as we all understand how hard it is to get the monetary resources to maintain our infrastructure and our improvements here, and make sure that where that funding is being allocated. I know Virginia Beach is certainly putting up a good portion of that, and I greatly respect that. But I just want to make sure, you know, when we're looking at what is the cost if you're paving 3 miles of roadway versus 3 miles of light rail, and in the future, is that the best investment, depending where it is. So, Mr. Chairman, I appreciate you indulging me and allowing me to ask those questions, and I certainly appreciate your input, sir.
Thank you. Any further questions? Seeing none, thank you. We will then go to the next presentation, which is sea level rise. An update. Did I miss one? Long-range plan?
I'm sorry.
I've missed one. We're at number 8, long-range transportation plan, challenges and strategies, the draft.
In the past 3.5 years, we have brought a number of reports for your approval regarding the 2040 long-range transportation plan. And today we have another draft report, challenges and strategies, and we have Mr. Nichols, our principal transportation engineer, to provide you a brief update on that report.
Okay. Thank you very much. As Camille mentioned, our 2040 long-range transportation plan is being released in a compendium of reports, and this one is called the Transportation Challenges and Strategies document. And this one is a fifth in a series of the series of reports. Some of the ones that we've released to this point are the visioning survey report, the list of committed and candidate transportation projects in the long-range plan, and also the project evaluation and scoring of these candidate projects. So as you would expect with a title like Challenges and Strategies, what this document looks at is the challenges presented in various aspects of our Hampton Roads transportation system, and then some of the strategies that are either in place or are planned for the future to help alleviate these challenges we have in our region. The report is broken into many different sections looking at all kinds of aspects of the transportation system in our region, falling under those that involve mobility and accessibility. So how do people get from point A to point B? The preservation, the safety, and security of our existing system. Some of the environmental concerns we have related to transportation, such as sea level rise impacts on transportation in our region, air quality and water quality. And then also the many financial concerns we have in terms of financing our existing system as well as new construction for our region. Today I'll go over three examples from this report, looking at congestion, active transportation, and safety. So I'll start with everybody's favorite topic of conversation, which is congestion in our region. Needless to say, we have numerous challenges when it comes to congestion in our region, and for the sake of time, I won't go over all of them, but I'll go over a couple of them here. Here at the TPO, we look at congestion levels of roadways through our region and produce these maps that show you during the peak periods what roadways are congested in our region. So the maps I'm showing you here are the existing congestion levels. Obviously, a lot of you know what some of these hotspots are throughout our region. Another thing we do is look at how we compare to other areas. And national studies have shown that congestion in our region is some of the worst compared to those other large metropolitan areas that are the same size. So in the most recent data, I believe we were the eighth highest congestion level among metropolitan areas that are between 1 and 3 million people. Another issue, obviously, is funding, and there's many, many, many different reasons for this. But heading into the future, some of the concerns we have in terms of funding levels is that vehicles are becoming more and more fuel efficient. So that's lowering the amount of gas that's purchased, which is decreasing the amount of taxes coming in to fund transportation. That's part of the reason House Bill 2013 adjusted some of the mechanisms for funding transportation in our region. Another concern we have is the lower fuel prices we're seeing this year. So in addition to vehicles being more fuel efficient, when the cost of fuel is down, the amount of funding that comes in to fund transportation goes down. And one other concern is maintaining our current system, whether it's regular roadways, whether it's the numerous bridges we have in our region, the amount of money needed in our region just to maintain the existing roadway network continues to go up and up, which eats into the funds that we can use to build new roadways and hopefully alleviate some of the congestion in our region. So in terms of some of the strategies we have, everybody in this room, I believe, is familiar with HRTAC and the regional funding mechanisms. So the regional funding pot of money was created to help alleviate the congestion at some of these worst locations in our region, such as 64 on the peninsula, across the Hampton Roads Harbor, high-rise bridge, for example. So that'll definitely help in terms of these notorious locations throughout the region where traffic congestion is currently occurring. There's also a number of other strategies that are much smaller in scale that we look at in terms of improving congestion levels, whether it's changing land use patterns such as town center, these areas where you live, work, and play all in the same area, for example. Public transportation, more active transportation, biking and walking, and also improving transportation operations, whether it's having safety service patrols out there to quickly remove crashes or improving traffic signal operations to help traffic move more quickly throughout corridors. So there's a number of strategies we look at, both small and large, in terms of trying to help improve congestion in our region. The next example I want to go over is active transportation. This would be biking, walking, things like that. There's increasing demand for biking and walking in our region. Although the numbers are small, the number of people that are biking and walking to work is increasing. And on top of that, according to household transportation survey data, we're seeing the number of people that bike and walk for recreation is also increasing quite a bit. So the number of people that are using active transportation facilities is increasing. Network gaps is a problem, not just in our region, but throughout the country. There's a number of facilities in place. However, the connectivity between all of these facilities is an issue. Safety is also an issue, particularly in our region over the last few years, where we've seen the number of crashes involving bicyclists and pedestrians increase quite a bit. In the end of last decade, we saw about 450 crashes per year. We're up over 700, pushing 800 crashes per year now. Whether this is entirely due to the extra number of people that are biking and walking in our region or if this is something else, We're not entirely sure, and we'll look at more in the future to help improve the safety of bicyclists and pedestrians in our region. And another challenge is maintaining our current facilities, particularly in the older urban areas where some of these sidewalks may be, you know, 100-year-old sidewalks where you have to maintain these facilities and have this money compete with other, obviously, maintenance dollars. In terms of some of the strategies we have, there's a number of committees that look at improving the planning for pedestrian, bike and ped modes of transportation in our region. Just to give one example, PAYBAC, which is Pedestrian and Bicycle Advisory Committee, gets together groups from our agency, from the localities, from VDOT, and also from bicyclist interest groups and pedestrian to help improve some of the facilities we have in our region. There's also a number of plans done throughout the region. For example, the Historic Triangle has been a champion of planning for active transportation for decades now, and they also have a number of facilities up there. Here at the HRTPO, we've started, or we've greatly expanded our planning for active transportation in recent years, including an active transportation research scan and also producing a facilities map of active transportation facilities in our region. And the state also has a statewide bicycle policy plan. There's also a number of multi-jurisdictional trails to help with this connectivity issue that are underway. Just to give a couple examples, the Virginia Capitol Trail between Richmond and Williamsburg, the last segment should be completed later this year. So the entire 50-plus mile segment will be done all the way from Williamsburg to Richmond by the end of the year. In addition, the Southampton Roads Trail, which will connect downtown Suffolk with the Virginia Beach Oceanfront when it's complete, is also underway with a segment in Suffolk under construction. And finally, infrastructure. For example, having facilities where you can park your bike, where you can maintain your bike if necessary. Traffix has installed some of these throughout the region to help make bicycling more friendly in terms of commuting. The final example I want to give is to look at the challenges and strategies related to safety. Obviously, one of the biggest challenges we have is just the impacts of crashes, you know, on families, on society as a whole. So, you know, any number of crashes, injuries, fatalities has a great impact, much greater than some of the other things we look at in terms of transportation. Another issue is there's actually been an increase in the number of crashes and injuries in our region over the last few years. So we saw a huge decrease in the number of crashes over the end of last decade. But starting with 2010, we're starting to see this number creep back up. So that's obviously a concern. Some of the strategies we have to improve safety. There's an effort that's called the Strategic Highway Safety Plan, and that's where stakeholders from all around the state come together and produce what we call a blueprint or a framework for how we're going to improve safety and how we're going to spend our money to improve safety. So we're actually in the process of starting up the next Strategic Highway Safety Plan, and hopefully in about a year from now we'll have a new framework for how we can improve safety in our region. There's also the Highway Safety Improvement Program, which is the funds that help improve safety, whether it's building new guardrails and places to help protect users that run off the roadway, or whether that's rumble strips that, you know, make you pay attention when you run off the side of the roadway, or for example a roundabout where at a location where maybe crashes were a big problem. So all this is funded with the Highway Safety Improvement Program. There's also something called road safety audits that we do, where a number of stakeholders go out to these high crash locations, whether it's engineers or planners, and also, for example, state police, since they're the ones who respond to a number of these crashes. And we go out to these locations and try to specifically find what might be causing these problems. You know, if we see that a whole bunch of left turn crashes are occurring, what might be the cause for this? So that we can figure out exactly how to spend the money, the best bang for the buck in terms of money, in terms of improving these high crash locations. And finally, there's a number of programs and educational efforts that are out there to improve safety, whether they're more regional or state in nature, such as Drive Safe Hampton Roads or Drive Smart Virginia, or whether they look at a specific topic related to safety, whether it's the Safe Routes to School program, which looks to improve safety around schools for kids, or Mothers Against Drunk Driving, for example, that looks to alleviate some of these drunk driving crashes. So this draft report that I went over very quickly here was open for public review, and it closed on June 11th. And we'll be back here at next month meeting to request approval of the final report. So with that, I'll be happy to take any questions you might have on this document.
Thank you. Any questions? Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, we are now at the sea level rise report update.
Okay. If you were here for the Hampton Roads Planning District Commission meeting earlier today, there was a briefing by Mr. McFarland on the status and where they are. They're taking the lead and with some of you localities in this region to look at the condition of sea level rise and make a number of plans for the future. I just wanted to make sure that you knew that on the TPO side, we have also done some work, and we've been working very closely with the staff of the Planning District Commission. But our task is to look at the sea level rise, recurrent flooding, and find out what's the impact on the roadway system and the infrastructure. So we have Mr. Bearfield here, our senior transportation engineer, to give you a brief update on where we are.
Thank you. Thank you, Camilla. Today I'd like to provide, like Camilla said, just a brief overview quickly of what our current and some of our future efforts are by the HRTPO staff on this very important topic of sea level rise. As many of you know, if you've lived here in the region, you know that this issue is very critical for coastal regions such as Hampton Roads. In fact, if you don't know this, Hampton Roads is the second most vulnerable region in terms of sea level rise in the United States behind the city of New Orleans. As sea levels they're rising at an accelerated pace, which will have significant impacts on our region. Some of the areas in our region are starting to see some permanent inundation take place. We're also starting to see more frequent flooding in those other areas. And then some of the areas in our region that have not experienced flooding will soon start to experience it in the near future. Sea level rise coupled with the impacts of storm surge as a result of hurricanes and other storms that pass through our area puts many of our transportation assets at risk. So this is a very important issue for the HRTPO to keep a close eye on as we move forward. Repetitive flooding at these critical transportation facilities can severely impact our travel and also hurt our regional and local economies. Simply put, when our streets flood, it results in our citizens missing important work time as well as personal property damage throughout our region. For these reasons, it's critical that the HRTPO staff remains proactive on this issue rather than reactive as we move forward. For those of you that sit on the HRPDC board, you're well aware of this issue. You're well aware that the HRPDC staff has taken a strong leadership role in this topic of sea level rise. Both our staff has been working closely with the PDC staff on this issue, and it's been recognized on a national level. We were requested about a month ago to speak at a national symposium that talked about environmental sustainability best practices for transportation in Washington, D.C. Both myself and Ben McFarland spoke about an initiative that we had worked on a couple years ago where we addressed sea level rise and storm surge impacts to our roadways that serve the military. We continue to be engaged in this issue with our partners on a university level, as well as folks such as VIMS, the Virginia Institute of Marine Science, and the HRPDC has recently began just last year, a regional committee to speak specifically to this issue for our region. It's called the HRPDC Sea Level Rise Advisory Committee, which meets about every other month. Our staff is also involved in what's called a Hampton Roads Sea Level Rise Intergovernmental Planning Pilot Project, specifically working on an infrastructure working group, which held its last meeting on Monday. We also are involved, the PDC staff and other stakeholders conduct what are called Hampton Roads Adaptation Forums periodically throughout our region, where they are able to showcase what some of the localities are doing to address this issue and to learn from their experiences. As Mr. McFarland spoke to the PDC this morning about the Dutch Dialogues. This is an event that's starting tomorrow and will take place through Tuesday. This is something where we're having a group from the Netherlands come in to speak to our region, to share their experiences and to identify strategies to combat the impacts of flooding and to improve water quality for our region. This is a inundation map that was put together by the HRPDC. You've probably seen this before. It shows our vulnerability to sea level rise through the year 2100. It shows four different scenarios. One is based on historical trends, which is represented in the blue area, the blue shaded areas, which show the inundation that's expected to occur, all the way from a low scenario of 2.6 feet to a high scenario of 7.5 feet. And this is expected by, like I said, by the year 2100. The PDC staff, is constantly tweaking this information to model these types of inundation maps. They expect that we would probably fall somewhere around the intermediate scenario. So moving forward, we plan to partner with the PDC staff to take their models and their inundation maps and overlay them with our transportation network to determine the impacts. Specifically, we have a study that's underway where we're conducting a vulnerability analysis of potential sea level rise and storm surge impacts to our regional roadways by the year 2045, which would be our next long-range transportation plan horizon year. We're going to be looking specifically at three different scenarios. Number one is a base scenario of sea level rise of 2 feet, which is a reasonable amount to expect within that time horizon. And then the second and third scenarios would be a sea level rise of 2 feet, coupled with the impacts of a 25-year storm scenario. And then we will also see the impacts to our roadways for a 50-year storm surge, just to get an idea of which roadways would be inundated under that condition. Now, over the last several years, we've been able to use the results from our TPO studies to refine some of the weighting factors within our project prioritization tool. The goal here is to use the results of this study that we've got underway to incorporate, for the first time, a sea level rise flooding component within this prioritization tool. In terms of next steps for this issue, as I mentioned, we plan to fully incorporate this important issue of sea level rise and flooding impacts into our planning process through the integration of our prioritization tool, which is an exciting thing for us. A lot of the national leaders and representatives are looking to us trying to see how we're going to do this because it's never been done before. So we're excited to embark on that. We also want to continue to coordinate with this issue with our local, regional, state, and federal partners. And then finally, we hope to provide these study results and other data by ourselves and the PDC to our localities for their future planning efforts, such as the local comp plans. That concludes my formal remarks today on this issue, and I'd be happy to take any questions that you have.
Thank you. Are there any questions? Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, last on the workshop agenda is House Bill 2, Statewide Transportation Prioritization Process Update.
You've heard earlier Mr. Malvin mentioned that the CTB approved...
Sorry, I keep forgetting that. The CTB approved the HB 2 statewide prioritization process, and we have this morning Mr. Rob Carey, the district administrator from Richmond, who has been involved from probably early on the process of developing this prioritization. So he's here to provide you a brief update.
Good morning. Again, my name is Rob Carey. I'm the Richmond district administrator, and I'm here Really, I shouldn't say on behalf of VDOT, because this project, this whole process, is really a Secretary of Transportation initiative. Director Mitchell could just as easily be up here giving it. It's a multimodal prioritization process, and so I just say that because I don't want people to leave thinking it's a VDOT process. It's a statewide multimodal process. Yesterday was a very significant day. The Commonwealth Transportation Board approved the HB2 policy, and I think from a personal standpoint, my 23 years of VDOT, probably the most impactful legislation in terms of which projects will be selected across the state and how money will be distributed to them. I wanted to start at a very high level. I know you've seen this before, but there's really three parts to this whole process. There's the VTrans 2040, which will really identify the needs on the various levels of the network, on the quarter statewide significance, the regional network, and on our local development areas. Those needs, once identified, projects submitted need to match up against those needs to move forward. That VTrans 2040 document is what we will screen projects against. If they successfully screen against the needs identified in that, then they'll be scored under House Bill 2. And a lot of attention, obviously, has been given to that scoring under House Bill 2, but it is important to recognize that there's a filter before you get to House Bill 2. And then lastly, House Bill 1887, which established the district grant program, established the statewide priority funding, and the state of good repair, is really how projects are funded, how that did away with the traditional funding formula that was set up back in 1986. So we have a new regime for funding there. Throughout this process, there's been extensive outreach. We've had 27 CTB hearings, either around HB2 itself or our six-year plan hearings, where we gathered input on House Bill 2. We've had stakeholder sessions in every one of the districts across the state, individual meetings with every MPO, and numerous presentations at stakeholder and association conferences as part of this outreach process. The prioritization process is an application process. We have the weighting frameworks and then the evaluation of the measures. And that application process is going to start in August. I'll have a slide later in the presentation that shows that. And there were, relative to the weighting framework, some changes adopted by the board in their final action yesterday as they approved it. And relative to the applications and who's eligible to submit them, on the high priority projects, corridors of statewide significance, regional entities, which would be MPOs around the state, PDCs, nonprofit transit providers, they are all considered regional entities. And you can see on the corridors of statewide significance, a regional entity like the Hampton Roads TPO could submit a project. Local governments can submit a project. That was a change from earlier iterations of the proposed process. Earlier on, they could not. That was changed to yes, they could submit with support from the regional entity. And lastly, the transit agencies can do that with support from the regional entity. And that is on the corridor's statewide significance. Really, it was felt that those projects really should be at our highest level on the statewide network and should represent regional interests and not just a local interest, but should serve the region as well. On the regional networks, you can see the regional entities can submit projects on there as well. Local governments can submit projects on the regional networks, and the transit agencies as well, with support from the relevant entity. A couple of things that were added yesterday in the final resolution that the board passed. Projects must be located within the boundaries of the applying agency. So local government, for example, can apply for a project within their county or city, but they cannot apply for one outside of it. If there are projects that cross a border, say a bridge and roadway project that spans a river between two jurisdictions, there is a provision where both could go together to submit jointly on that. And also what was added, a provision where the Commonwealth Transportation Board can choose to submit, don't have to, but can choose to submit up to two projects for consideration per solicitation. And my take on that, those would be the highest level projects that, you know, if you think of some of the things that span statewide interest, there may not be an individual MPO or PDC or county that would necessarily see that as their number one priority, but from a statewide perspective, a large project that span multiple PDCs and MPOs very well might make sense for the Commonwealth Transportation Board to put in a project like that. On the construction district grant program, and that is 27.5% of the available funding goes to that district grant program. Only local governments may submit projects for consideration for the local district grants. The projects must be located within the boundary of the relevant local government, and local governments may submit a joint application, as I mentioned earlier, if you have something that spans a border between local governments. On the screening process, I talked earlier about high priority projects having to meet a need identified for a corridor of statewide significance or a regional network. Construction district grant programs, projects must meet a need identified for a corridor of statewide significance, regional network, urban development area, or safety. If it's a safety related need, that could be anywhere on any part of the network that could be done within the district grant program. You see here a slide, and this is one that, because it was just done yesterday, it needs to be updated, and I would just draw your attention what the board did yesterday. The top half of that slide is what was presented to the board in March. In June, what they adopted yesterday is correct in the bottom, except that top line, Category A. The board yesterday at their meeting chose to reduce in Category A, economic development that you see on the slide is 10, was reduced to 5%. Accessibility that was 10 was increased to 15%. Safety, which was 10, was reduced 5% to 5%. Environmental quality remained the same at 10%, and land use was increased to 20%. So across the top there, it should read 45, 5, 15, 5, 10, and 20. And that was the final determination of the board as the only changes relative to the weightings were in Category A. Here you see the framework for the weightings that was used across the state for the MPOs and PDCs in the March draft. And I'm going to, the next slide, and I might flip them back and forth between the two, shows what was adopted yesterday. And you can see, as example, in the Hampton Roads area, that was Category A for the weighting frameworks. You'll notice in the revised, the area of Gloucester went to D. That was in concurrence with what the county was looking for there. You can also see on here that Richmond went from an A in March to a B. That was something they sought. Fredericksburg, MPO area, the FAMPO area, was originally a B. They asked to go to a Category A as they see congestion being very important for their citizens who, many of whom commute to Northern Virginia every day. And then in the western part of the state, the New River Valley area originally was in Category B and some other areas around Roanoke, and you can see the changes there. But for Hampton Roads most specifically, really no change except that Gloucester change, which was something that the county had sought there and the Commonwealth Transportation Board agreed with. The measures that will be used to evaluate, and one of the things that I would say around these measures that I think is very good in the direction that Virginia went with this, they're very forward-looking. They're not looking in the rearview mirror. You know, simply the fact that a roadway maybe has a safety issue or that it has congestion didn't mean it automatically scored well. What these measures do is they look at that project that's being proposed to see if it does something about that issue. As an example, if you have a project that has safety issues, but the an area of the roadway with safety issues, but the proposed project is to install a camera. Well, the camera is not going to affect that safety issue if the safety issue is single vehicle run off the road crashes. So that wouldn't necessarily score well in terms of what the impact of that project on safety. Whereas if that project were to install rumble strips and the typical crash is single vehicle run off the road, it would score very well because that's a very effective treatment, very cost-effective treatment. So what all of these measures try to do is look forward out the windshield rather than in the rearview mirror, not the history of what's happened, but what will the projects do to make that better going forward. So you can see in safety, 50% of the weight of the score in safety is based on the expected reduction in fatal and severe injury crashes. That's directly in line with the state's safety plan to try to reduce fatal and severe injury crashes. And 50% is based on the expected reduction in the rate of fatal and severe injury crashes. In congestion factor, we've got 50% of it based on the expected reduction in person hours of delay up to the posted speed limit, and 50% based on the expected increase in person throughput within the corridor. Economic development factor area, 60% is based on the support that the project will provide for economic development plans in that area, 20% based on the expected improvement to travel time reliability on the facility, and 20% based on improved intermodal access and efficiency. This is an area that changed some. Certainly that addition of the reliability was a direct result of some of the concerns raised by the CTB in earlier meetings around wanting to reflect reliability in the measures. In the accessibility factor area, 60% of it is based on the cumulative increase in access to jobs in the region, 20% on the cumulative increase in access to jobs for disadvantaged populations. That 20% for disadvantaged populations was originally in the environmental area as a measure within environmental. It was moved over to accessibility, and some other additions were done in environmental that we'll talk about. So that's not a new factor, it's just in a different location now. And then 20% was based on an increased access to multimodal choices. The environmental factor areas I was just talking about, 50% of the project is the degree to which a project is expected to reduce air emissions and greenhouse gases, and that's similar to what was in it originally. The addition that was put in was the other 50%, which was based on the potential impact to natural, cultural, and historic resources. Originally, that was not included. At the time, it was felt that the NEPA process adequately addressed that, but we got a lot of input that people wanted to see that included. So we did that. We also, as I said, moved that accessibility for disadvantaged populations over from environmental over to the accessibility area. And then the last one, the land use factor area, and land use only applies in the large MPO areas around the state, 200,000 or greater populations like Hampton Roads. And 100% of that is based on the support of transportation efficient land use patterns. On the environmental side, the potential impacts to natural and cultural resources, you can see here what was listed in the May draft of the policy, and that what that basically did was to sum within a quarter mile buffer around the project the land areas that would be conservation lands, species and habitat, cultural resources, and wetlands. And then that was, back in May, was going to be scaled based upon the type of environmental document that was going to be required by the project. In the final policy that was adopted yesterday by the board, you see we still have that total acreage of land within a quarter mile of the four project, the four categories that I talked about earlier. But the scaling has changed. The scaling impact and assigning points based on the type of environmental document. Now, if the project requires an EIS, we'll count 50% of the acreage that could potentially be impacted. If it's an environmental assessment, we'll count 30%, and a categorical exclusion will only count 10% of that acreage. And the points will be based on if a project has very little or no impact at all, that will be the one that scores the highest, the one that obviously that has the more impacts in those various categories at the top will score lower. And all of the scoring, I should say, my simple analogy that I use with people around the scoring is, the scoring is based on all the other projects that are being looked at right then. There's no gold standard, it's whatever is being looked at in that particular round of scoring. So my analogy is the Olympics. If you're running the 100-meter dash, you don't have to set a world record to get the gold medal. You just have to beat the other runners in that particular race. If you do, you get the gold medal. In the case of our scoring, if you happen to be the best performing project, you get that 100 points, and everybody else is scaled based on the best project. So the fact that a project scores 85 points in this round, in the next round, it might score 90 points or it might score 75 based on the other projects under consideration, how the best projects in that group of projects weigh in compared to the one you're looking at. So I just wanted to mention that because year to year, these will change based on the group of projects being looked at. The land use policy consistency and the points awarded, as I talked about, we've got we want to promote walkable, bicycle-friendly, mixed-use development. We want to support infill development. We want to reduce regional VMT, and that's going to use the MPO plan and the regional model to look at that VMT. Promoting designated urban development areas and having access management plans or corridor overlays. That's what was in the May draft. And there were some slight changes, one thing being how the points were scaled based on the number of non-SOV users. What was recommended and adopted yesterday, promoting walkable, bicycle-friendly mixed-use development, supporting the infill development, and having access management plan or corridor overlay in place that exceeds the VDOT minimum access management standards. And the scaling, as you flip back a slide, was based on the number of non-SOV users. It changed now to basically a more of a density factor. If you're doing good things to support land use and you're in an area that's got that high numbers of future employment, high numbers of future population, divided by that area, the area, acres within that buffered area. So that's how that is factored. You'll see at the top there, it talks about that up to 5 points can be awarded for how it does in promoting those walkable communities, infill and so forth. And then those 5 points will be scaled to the individual project based on the on that formula there at the bottom. This is, again, I had provided this before the board adopted it. The board obviously did adopt the HB2 process, and the first round of projects will be considered for fiscal year 17 through 23, six-year plan update. So next, a year from now, they adopted the six-year plan yesterday. So the next six-year plan that they adopt will take into account these measures. There will be $500 million. That's a little bigger number than was available a month or two ago as better economic projections have come in. There's $500 million for high priority projects and $500 million for the construction district grant program. So you can see there's a considerable amount of money that will be available for consideration under this program. VDOT DRPT will be reaching out for projects from the various people who are able to apply for them beginning on August 1st. I would say that between now and August 1st, the DRPT staff and VDOT staff are more than ready and willing to assist local governments as they start to consider which projects and the MPO as well, as they consider which projects they might want to put forward. Because it is going to be critical that these projects, when they're submitted, have the best scope and budget and schedule that they can have. Because there are provisions in the policy that if a project comes in at a certain estimate, and then if that estimate crosses certain thresholds going forward, it may have to go back and be rescored. So, you know, the best thing for anybody to do there is have a good estimate on the project going in so that it doesn't re-enter the process and have to get rescored and potentially not be prioritized in a future round. But VDOT and DRPT staff are very, very much able and willing to help. Obviously, this area has a lot of staff resources and expertise and studies that will support that. Some other areas around the state don't have that. And, you know, the secretary has made it very clear that no local government will have to hire a consultant in order to apply for a project under House Bill 2. So VDOT and DRPT staff are there to assist with that and basically try to be their consultant as they work through that process. We will have information available on the website to assist the sponsors in identifying potential projects. And then the evaluation of all those projects, once they come in, they'll be due right at the beginning of October, and then we'll have October through January to score all of those projects and then in February present that to the board. And obviously, you can see in this process, it's about scoring, but you have to remember the scores in the end, the House Bill 2 scoring process requires that those scores be divided by the cost of the project, and that will be a big factor. So the most efficient, effective projects will be the ones that do the best. Some other items that the board discussed over the last 2 days was, you know, there is some future things that have to be looked at. The frequency of project solicitation. Do we do this every year? Do we do it this year and next year? And then, you know, do we consider maybe it should be an every other year thing, or should it be every year? The programming rules to develop the six-year plan. Okay, we'll come up with a prioritized list and provide that to the Commonwealth Transportation Board. But how do they want to look at that list? And because they don't have to pick projects in priority. What type of information would they need? So that's some more information that we'll want to do that. How we commingle funds between programs, and then how we deal with the smart roadway and unpaved road set-asides. And obviously, the one thing I should have started out by saying with this, this is House Bill 2.0. It's a beginning. It's a very good beginning. We are so much further ahead than we would have been without this process, but it is 2.0. There will be a 2.1 and a 2.2. As things go forward and more data becomes available, we see how the process works, we see where things need to be tweaked. That's certainly on everybody's radar that this you know, will adjust over time. And you know as well as I do, just in our lives today, technology, the availability of data is ever growing, and the data we may have available to us 5 years from now that we don't have today certainly may play a role in House Bill 2 and being able to provide better detail and better measures on some of these. So I think it's a very good process. Is it perfect? It's not perfect, no, but it's certainly, without this, we didn't have anything like this. So we're way better ahead as a state in dealing with that. And certainly the opportunity for improvement going forward is well recognized by everybody. The schedule for the overall process I mentioned, if you look in the upper right-hand quadrant, here we are, June, the CTB adopted it. July, DRPT staff and VDOT staff, we want to coordinate with local governments, PDCs, MPOs on projects and make sure that everybody is getting a well-defined project and scope and estimate. Then August to September, we'll be soliciting those projects from local governments and regional entities. October, the applications are due. October through January, we'll screen and evaluate those projects. And then in the January-February timeframe, those scores will be released. And then from February to April, and with the normal six-year plan hearing process by the board, the board will consider that information and select which projects they want to do. In April, they will release a draft six-year plan, go out for public hearings around the state to get input on that draft, and then next June, we'll adopt the first round of projects that went through this process and then use it going forward. That concludes the presentation I had. If you have any questions, I'd be more than happy to take them, and thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Any questions, Mr. Carey?
Mr. Chairman, I just want to add that the district will be having two workshops in July, so that'll be communicated out to the staff. First one's July 10th at the TPO, and then the second one's July 15th at the district office in Suffolk. So these are, again, a presentation and workshop on moving forward and filling out applications.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Carey. Okay, we are now at a public comment part of the meeting agenda. I'll call them in order. Presented John Gergely, followed by Mr. Ellis James, and then Frank Paps. So if you would be ready in that order. Thank you.
Good afternoon. This week, the Virginia Pilot published op-ed by Philip Chouquette. Is certainly not a man without credentials in his room. He referenced the 2001 congestion study that the HRTPO developed and basically questioned why you have eliminated the Hampton Roads Bridge Tunnel from consideration from adding capacity to Hampton Roads Bridge Tunnel. And he made a darn good argument. basically that study, it was commissioned to support the justify the third crossing, but the HRBT won out as the added capacity HRBT rat won out as being the best way to reduce congestion. Mr. Chouquet made a good argument. He didn't list the other six studies that the HRTPO has commissioned since then, since 2009. Many of you weren't here for any of those studies, but every one of them, without question, said that the best way to reduce congestion around the HRBT is to add capacity to HRBT. Just every study you've ever commissioned says that, but you just ignored it. You just dropped it. And this discussion with the HB2 prioritization, it brings to mind the prioritization study that you all did in 2010. And you know, there's articles in the paper about this HRB2 prioritization. They mentioned tweaking if necessary. And tweaking is a funny word. It could just mean adjusting for things you didn't think of before, but it also can be some shadowy ideas. In the 2010 study, the HRBT was the high and above the best project for reducing congestion in the area for bridge tunnel projects. But shortly after that, another slide just appeared out of the air called the third crossing. And it had a much higher score than the HRBT or anything else in the prioritization study. And no one would admit who named it Patriots Crossing. But it had a large score. It down in the corners, a little bitty thing set assumes 80% funding. Now, I had private conversations, and basically, I was told by staff that this is unofficial. It's just one of the mayors asked for the study as a what-if study, which, you know, is an illogical thing to do. But shortly after, other slides with the same thing, the 80% disappeared, or it got down to real fine print. You could barely read it. And it was sold all over the area. It was done many presentations to many groups around town. And I firmly believe that influenced the HRTPO to choose to make your resolution for the third crossing and this thing called Patriots Crossing. So tweaking's funny. And what this brings to mind is this prioritization process, and a prioritization process that the HRTA is going to have to do for your projects. It's only good if it's honest. It's only good if no one screws with it after it's done. And I really question who's going to monitor and who's going to audit the prioritization process that you're doing, and it's being done for the HB2.
Thank you, Mr. Gerg.
And one other thing, you still don't print public comments in this in your minutes. It's certainly not for save a paper, but I think what the public says to you should be printed in your minutes. Thank you very much.
They're on the website, Mr. Gerg.
We haven't done it.
Thank you. Ellis James. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman Price. My name is Ellis W. James. I reside in the city of Norfolk. And there are lots of things to talk about today in transportation, but I'd like to focus on just one item. May the 12th, Chamber of Commerce sent a letter that didn't arrive until June the 15th concerning the proposed EPA ozone regulations. I hope that each of you will secure a copy and peruse it, because there are some significant misrepresentations in this letter that I was astounded to see, and there are even references to the fact that individual automobile owners and drivers are going to have problems and serious cost and so on as a result of these new regulations. I know there are lots of people all over the country who are unhappy with EPA, but their reference in this particular letter to the fact that the national air quality standards have consistently improved since 1980 is significant to note. Many people and organizations had to fight tooth and nail to get some beginnings of improvement in the air quality. And now those forces, same forces who were against that in the very beginning, are now coming to the fore again to try to stop EPA requirements that will help us protect our seniors and our children and all of the residents and taxpayers. I hope that you will take the time. It's only a short two-pager. I hope you will take the time to look at it closely. You will find in the letter a list of a lot of organizations, not one single health-oriented organization, no asthma association endorsement of their objection to the new standards. That is something that's very important. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Papson. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, people. I've been here before. Usually I'd be running my mouth about, you know, hurry up and get your jobs done on 64, 264. Blah, 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 we need the roads. Today, I'm going to do a little bit of a turnaround. I have been reading HB2, and I read 1887. And my question is this. We are in this area, category A, which is the red area shown on there, which means, according to the recommended factor weighing framework of June 2015, category A, congestion, is the major thing. And the light rail for Virginia Beach does nothing for congestion, as every single study has shown. Economic development. Economic development, claimed by the city, is supposed to be where jobs are created, but all of the economically developable land that the city already owns, none of it is on light rail line, none of it, which means light rail will serve none of it, which means people wanting to go to work will have to, one, either get in their car and drive to light rail, ride on light rail, and then get another alternate means of transportation to their jobs, which means additional time away from their families, away from their work. It'll take them longer to get there and longer to get home. So it brings back to another question. If HB2 is the law of the land, and this project for light rail in the city of Virginia Beach does not meet the criteria, how did you people ever say yes to it? Because that's the point that I don't understand. It doesn't serve the purpose that it stated. Even in the environmental study done, given that big, you know, 3,500 page book, which I didn't bring, I have it. Even that said that the expectations realized in this request by the city are not reasonable. Economic development can only be done when people want to move to a community with their business. And if their business is being saddled with the additional cost of operating a light rail system that does not serve the community, that is an additional burden that they carry. Let's go to environmental projects, environmental things. All these park and ride positions that you're going to build, these are all areas that are not going to have, what is the word, pervious surfaces, which means you're going to have runoff problems with water. you're going to have more flooding problems. Ah, and there's my time. But anyways, there are many, many factors that were never taken into consideration with this project. A lot of people presented a lot of good information, and it was ignored. And I really wish you'd reconsider. Thank you, sir.
We had no, we're on item 12, no public comments presented at the time of printing. So we're now at item 13, approval of the consent agenda, and a motion to do that is in order. So moved. Who did the second? Thanks. Straight, good. All those in favor of the consent agenda, say aye, please.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? Good. We're now at item 14, where we have the 3-month tentative schedule as listed in your packet. We also have item 15, correspondence of interest, and item 16, the minutes of the last TPO meetings. And item 17 is information segment for you. Item 18 is old or new business. Is there any? Hearing or seeing none, we stand adjourned. Thank you.